Hey, well, praise the Lord. Let's all rise up. I got a word for you today from the Lord. Elbow your neighbor and say, you came on a good day. Yeah. Hey, if you're going to be here on any day, might as well be when you get a word from the Lord. Hallelujah. Say, tell me about it. Well, I'm about to. So out of Galatians 6:9 is where we're going to start. It's a good place to start. It says, and let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. Let's pray. Lord, we just ask that the word go forward, Lord God, and you touch lives and do it through the anointing and the power, the wonder-working power of the Holy Ghost. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. So you guys may be seated right now. And before we pick up the offering, I got a quick story I think you guys are going to enjoy. And then we got a quick video, got a 3-minute video. Let me read this one more time. I'll tell you a story. It says, and let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. So we can't give up because somebody's right on the verge of getting born again. We have to believe that every time somebody comes in the sanctuary of the Lord, that there's a possibility, say possibility, possibility of somebody getting saved. So I'm excited about it too. So here's how this goes. I was at a meeting on Friday night, and there was a lot of people there and a lot of evangelicals, and it was a wonderful meeting. And we were promoting Jesus, and we were promoting America. And them are some of my two favorite subjects. So there was a preacher that came up to me, and he said, hey, I want you to know the such and such families here, and you spoke into their life. And this, I said, oh, okay. And I went over there, and I met this lady, and she says, I want you to know, she says, my son passed away last month, and he's a man that I went to school with, and wonderful, wonderful guy. And in the midst of this conversation I was having with this lady, she says, and we brought him to your church, and you told him about the love of Jesus. And he ended up getting saved. So I thought about that. I thought about that because you never know really kind of where people are with the Lord. So I wanted to take the opportunity. And it's not fixed people that come in church. It's people that come in that need to be fixed. Or the Bible interprets it as not the healthy ones that come in church, it's the unhealthy. And it can be healthy as well. But the point is this, is God fixes things that are a mess. And he helps out things that are good. So if you're here and your life is going through some situations, I was talking to a brother here earlier, and he said, man, things are kind of crazy. And I said, well, doesn't that sound just like family? Families are pretty crazy, and they do crazy things, and that's why we need a crazy good God in Jesus. Well, let me pray, and then we'll tell you why you came here today. So, Lord, I just pray, and, you know, we look at the crazy times out there, and we almost laugh, and we know that you got to laugh when we look down at our family situation. Some of these people, Lord God, we work with or can be a handful sometimes. But my prayer today is that it goes out and helps these people in their situations. And Lord God, as your children support your work at your church today, I pray that they understand that they got a stake in the game here, Lord God. They got some skin in the game here at Have Bible, and we appreciate that. We ask you to bless their gift and the giver. In Jesus' name, amen. So let me set up this video. Go ahead and let the offering be picked up. Let me set up this video. So this is a song that is by Third Day, and it's called Born Again. And that's what we're talking about is being born again. So when you hear the word born again, the Greek translation means born from above. Or if you hear me talking about save or salvation or born again or something like that, you'll know that it's this born again experience. And I believe this song is really, really anointed. It's written and sung under the anointing of God, and I believe it's going to touch you with this anointing through the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is so extremely powerful. He wants to baptize you today, and I'll talk about that. So let's just do the video, and I'll come back up.
Born again. Till today I found myself, after searching all these years. And the man that I saw, he wasn't at all who I thought he'd be. But I was lost when you found me here, and I was broken beyond repair. And then you came along and you sang your song over me. It feels like I'm born again. It feels like I'm living for the very first time. For the very first time. Yeah. A feeling in my soul, and I pray that I'm not wrong, that the life I have now, it is only the beginning. It feels like I'm born again. It feels like I'm living for the very first time.
Let's pray for God's word. Lord, we ask you to bless your word today as the message goes forth under the anointing of the Holy Ghost, Lord God, that it touch lives and regenerate hearts and transform lives. We're turning it over to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Born again or born from above. So turn with me in the book of Romans in the 10th chapter. And we will also be in Deuteronomy today. But when you hear me say being saved or born again, you'll know that the actual Greek translation means to be born from above. And so I got excited about this. So I was in a deacons and pastors meeting this morning, and I challenged our deacons and pastors here today. So if you see them when you leave here, just kind of ask them this. So I do this, and I asked them, I said, do you remember where you were when you got born again? Because sometimes, you know, sometimes as we're working in the ministry, sometimes you kind of forget about it. And every one of them said, yeah. And I asked them specifically. I said, where were you? Where were you? And I asked them, and they all had a very definitive answer. So if you don't have a definitive answer, you might want to talk to God right now while the service is going on. Go, you know what? I don't really remember where I gave my life to Jesus. And that's something that you and God will work out here today. Amen. I can't work that out for you. I'll show you how to get there. I'll show you that he so wants to be in a relationship with you, and it's a good relationship, and it's a relationship where he's not going to leave you or bail out on you when the times get tough. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Because sometimes the relationships that we're in work out as long as everything's working, but when things get a little bad, then it's like, you know what, I'm thinking about getting out of this. Jesus won't. He don't care how bad it gets. And that's the cool thing about being born again. It's a great thing. So I asked the guys, I proceeded to ask them, I said, hey, do you remember not only where you got saved, but do you have the same zeal that you used to have when you got saved? So sometimes when we get saved, we want to tell everybody about Jesus, and we got our Bibles, and we got our little carrying cases, and our highlighters, and our markers, and we're at every Bible study in town, and these kind of things, and you may want to ask yourself that today, too. And I asked them, here's the final question. I asked them, I said, well, how'd you feel after you got born again? They said, every one of them said free. Free. Say free. Free. That's what being born again is. It's kind of like being regenerated. It's kind of like being rebuilt. And as I think about being rebuilt, I think about my Harley motor that I blew up on the men's retreat on the way back. So it's got to be rebuilt. Guys, amen. And now it's a way for me to up the horsepower on it. That's a guy excuse, you know. Yeah, babe, I got to get more horsepower. But anyways, back to the born-again experience. So I think about being born again, and I want to do whatever it takes to get people saved because I believe it's important. And I don't ever want to, like, slide that at the back of the thing. Like, it's not really important. We'll, like, talk about something else. My heart's desire is for people to get saved. And then I want to teach them and grow them up in the kingdom of God. Amen? So I thought I'd share that with you. So in Romans chapter 10, verse 1, it says, brother, my heart's desire and prayer to God for them is that they may be saved or born again or born from above. So regenerated, if you will. I don't know if I told you this, but I want to at least say it again. That this preacher that I was talking to at this meeting that we was at, he put his hand on my shoulder and he just spoke right back into my life. He said, the power comes from the Word of God. And it was just like, you know that and I know that, but it's nice when somebody, oh God, it's nice when somebody does that. It's like a B12 shot. It's just like he put his hand on me, he said, the power's in the, I go, oh, yes. Oh, yes. Do that with me. Oh, yes. No, that's stupid. Don't do that. I don't know. But it really did that in my spirit. I was like, yeah, all right. Now let me get up to the buffet now. Yeah. Took a double scoop of green beans and I was on my way. Hello. For I bear witness that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge, for being ignorant of the righteousness of God. Stop for a second. They had head knowledge of God. I think people can have head knowledge and not have Jesus in their heart. And church is starting to agree with that. Well, Jesus, Jesus. Everybody knows Jesus. The demons know Jesus, and they know he's powerful. Say powerful. Powerful. Say how powerful is he? Well, I'll tell you a story. Tell me a story. So I most of our cars have certain types of bumper stickers on them. They're usually something about America or something about Jesus, usually me and my wife, or my helmet or my bike or whatever, because these are my two favorite subjects, the red, white, and blue, and Jesus. They go hand in hand. Right. Hello, Americans. And I think as Americans, it's not our job to kneel down or necessarily sit. It's time for us all to get up and do our duty. Amen? Well, apparently, the guy driving behind me the other day didn't think so. So he must have seen some of my bumper stickers, and he may be watching today on Roco. If you are, praise God. I hope you get saved, sir. But he wanted to show me his IQ. He felt like he needed to show me his IQ. So he came up on my bumper, and he was about like 1 inch from my bumper. And you know, I was driving up the street, and I'm just, you know, anybody ever do the flesh like spirit man? You know, woo-hoo, where are we going to go here? And being a holy man, I had to go, yeah, you ain't going to get too much closer here. Or, but he raises his hand and he's showing me his IQ with his center finger. It's one. Looked over and I go, got it. And he ran up on me again and he raised his hand. He said, I need to show you, I only got 1% IQ. I wanted you to know. And I thought we was going to get to a red light, and we didn't. God was so gracious that we just moved on. He went his way, I went my way. And so Jesus is offensive to people. Some of you guys know what I'm talking about. And why is it offensive? Because I think it speaks volume and power. And whether you're a believer or not, it still speaks volume and power. And people get offended by it because what it does is it makes you reflect on your life. You know, whether you're born again. And people get really uptight about it. And they're like, oh, is he going to come and talk about Jesus again? And yeah, pretty much, I'm going to. And I have that right. Living in America, I can talk about Jesus wherever I want to. And you know my views on the flag. I think that we love the flag and we love everybody that's defended it. And we believe in this church, when it comes in, everybody should rise in honor of it and all the people it represents. So back to Romans in chapter 10, talking about this born-again experience, it's important to know that there's somebody bigger than me, and I have to submit to this person or man or God-man as we know him. His name is Jesus and his Christ. And his title is Christ, which means Messiah. Okay, so it's not real hard to understand that. And I use the analogy of my daughter when this Bible study teacher, Craig Tebow, led my daughter to the Lord. He used a Rubik's Cube. And some of you guys have seen these evangelistic cubes. And what it was it was a picture of you being here and God being here. And there's a chasm in between. And the chasm is filled by the cross at Calvary. And you can come to the Lord through the cross at Calvary. So I want you to know that you can go to the Lord the same way, but you'll have to choose the atoning work that he did some 2,000 years ago. Amen? And I'm so glad that people are getting saved, and we baptized four, and three or four of them are over here today. So we got four people that were baptized last night, so praise God. It says, let's just go down to verse 4. It says, for Christ is the end of the law of righteousness to everyone who believes. So that means Christ is the fulfillment of the law. We don't have to fulfill the law anymore because Christ fulfilled it for us. He did what we couldn't do so we can get to where we're wanting to get to. Amen? Does that make sense? So when Jesus died on the cross and the veil was torn from the holy place to the holiest of holies, the high priest settled that once and for all. And now I have access through the blood of Jesus that I can get there. If so, I need to. Amen? And this is kind of like almost Bible study mode. So you can guys, once you're born again, you can get into the holiest of holies where God resides. Amen? So that's kind of cool. All right, it says for Moses, I'm in verse 5, it says, for Moses writes about righteousness that is based on the law, that the person who does the commands shall live by them. But the righteousness based on faith says, do not say in your heart who will ascend to heaven, that is to bring Christ down, or to descend into the abyss, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you and in your mouth and in your heart. So it's not like, you know, hey, we got to go see Jesus at another place. We got to go get him, or I got to go to some special church. I got to do some special service. It ain't like that at all. It's near you. He starts in the heart. He changes the heart, and we're going to be going into Deuteronomy chapter 30. And this little excerpt, this thing that the Apostle Paul extracts out of here is in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 12 through 14. So you can make a note there. We're going there. And what he's saying is he works on your heart, And then the confession is what's going on in your heart. So it's a, you confess what's going on in your heart, and that's your proclamation. So that's the, or the declaration that you make today. Hopefully, if you're not born again, you'll make that proclamation today. Amen? So that's what he's talking about there. So it's very near, and all you have to do is accept or submit, get Jesus in your heart, ask him to come and live in your heart, and then make that proclamation. It's very important. Hallelujah. Look at your neighbor and say, you need to do that today. Okay, so go with me into Deuteronomy chapter 30. And this is real powerful. And I always kind of like to set this up so everybody understands that this is the God of the Old Testament is no different than the God of the New Testament. He has the same character, still saves and all that despite time and space. It says, he goes in and he says, and when all these things come upon you, so he's talking to the nation of Israel, the blessing and the curse, and if you're a born-again believer, you're grafted into the kingdom of Israel by Jesus Christ. And the church said, amen. Which I set before you. So he's talking to the nation of Israel, and he always sets stuff before the people, and he's doing that today. Life or death? Life or death. He sets that before you. And you can choose life, eternal life, or you can choose a curse as we know it, and damnation. Amen? So that's your choice. You can choose Jesus or not. You can walk out here and go, you know what? I don't believe in that Jesus stuff. You will one day. Everybody will believe in Jesus one day. Everybody goes before the CEO. Can I keep going now? Okay, we're going to pick up a little speed. And it says, and return to the Lord your God and you and your children. And watch this. And what does it say? Class, comma, and obey his voice. There's where the whole deal is, man. You know, I was really cool with the whole Jesus thing. But when that guy pulled on my bumper, let me tell you something, Jack. Oh, yeah, I'm as red-blooded as any American man. And I wanted to pull that emergency brake. I was like, yeah, what's up, dude, with the finger and the whole thing? But I have to obey and not operate in the flesh. It's easy to operate in the flesh. I could have got out of the car, slammed the door, and showed him my IQ, too. Can I get back to the word? So it's everybody's got to be obedient to the word. Watch this. Or not. Or not. You walk away and go, you know what, man? Donnie, I ain't worried about it. We're just going to slug it out right there in Dorset Road. And then the Maryland Heights would have came on and said, oh, Pastor Pat, we see that you're back. Been 16 years since we've seen you. That'd make the paper, wouldn't it? Can I keep going? Well, don't act like it ain't funny for you, too. Oh, Grandpa, there you are. Let's get back to his word. So it's the powers in the word. So, but I got to say, I'm just going to be totally honest. I feel like I got so much word downloaded in me. It kind of keeps the seatbelt. It keeps the seatbelt on when you're wanting to take it off. Hello? So sometimes we need to stay strapped in, Terry, a little bit longer and let it pay. You know, after about 2 minutes, I was like, oh, I'm cool. You're driving down the road, you go, everything's cool. I got my hot coffee, and this guy's miserable, and I'm praying. I turned up joy up in him. Yeah! Is anybody praising God in here but me today? I got to get to the message here. This is all free. So go slide down with me. So he says, obey his voice and all that I command you today with all your heart and with all your soul. Then the Lord your God will restore your fortunes. And you do whatever you want with the fortunes, financial, physical, spiritual, whatever, and fortunes, and have mercy on you, and he will gather you again from all the peoples where the Lord your God has scattered you. If you're outcast or in the uttermost parts of heaven, from there the Lord your God will gather you, and from there he will take you. And the Lord your God will bring you into the land. I always like when he says into the land. Whether you got a farm or not, you got to love just the word land. You go, you know what? Guys love land, even the little chunk, the postage stamp that they got in front of their house, you know? Land, guys just, oh, yeah, well, that's my lawn. That's my lawn. Not very big. And it,
Yeah. They buy tools and stuff. We weeded it. We weed whacked it. And they make an edge on it. Oh, they made an edge on that sidewalk, buddy. Land. But this maybe this isn't the little postage stamp that we all kind of live on. Maybe this land is like big. Can you imagine like big land? And I just think like that. I think like that. That prayer of Jabez, oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory and keep me from evil. I pray that over and over. Pray that prayer sometime and just go, enlarge my territory. God will enlarge it, I promise you, if you'll ask. Hallelujah. So just say land. Okay, now let's move on. That your fathers possess and that you may possess it. And he will make you more prosperous and numerous than your fathers. And the Lord your God will circumcise your heart. That means he's cutting back the crust and the things that are in the way so he can get to you. He's probably doing that right now. So soften up a little bit. If you came in here with you were a little bowed up or you were a little, you know, you were just soften up a little bit. Just let God just go, you know, I'm going to let the word just work on me. It'll do you good. Hallelujah. So you will love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul that you may, what? Live. And the Lord God will... the Lord God will put all the curses on the foes and the enemies who persecuted you. So that means the fight will be the Lord's, and you shall again obey the voice of the Lord and keep all his commandments that I command you today. The Lord your God will make you, what does it say, class? Abundantly prosperous in all the work of your hand. I mean, with all the work of your hand, wouldn't it be nice to actually produce something? And Terry stopped me in the hallway today. He goes, man, he goes, you had a heck of a hay crop this year. I go, yeah, I threw out a lot of seed. No, you miss that. You throw out a lot of seed, you'll get a big crop. You don't throw any seed out, you ain't going to get no crop. You don't work hard, you're not going to reap any rewards. Hello. You go out to my farm, my barn's full. It's all the way out to the end. All four bays, they're packed full of hay. We threw out a lot of seed and a lot of fertilizer, and boy, we reaped a harvest. Same spiritually speaking. Throw out a lot of seed, you'll reap a big harvest. Come on, church, let's get on board with this. Let's sit around like a spiritual ding-dong and go, I wonder if God's going to bless me. What'd you throw out there? You prayed for anybody? Nope. Been to church? Nope. How's everything working for you? Amen? Just kind of, let's just, hallelujah. All right, let's jump up to 11, and then I'm going to go back to Romans. It says, for this commandment that I command you today is not too hard for you. Praise God for that. Say, give me an example. Well, I tell my wife that she is old school, my daughter's new school, and I'm no school. All I'm saying is this. It can't be too hard for guys like me, or we'd miss the whole thing. The commandment is just bow to the Lord. I'll make it simple for you, and ask him to come into your heart. That I don't know how to explain it any other way than that. Just ask him to come into your heart, and will he do a miraculous miracle in your life? He will, absolutely. Will my life be completely different? Absolutely, 100% be different. It will, because that's what he does. So I want you to check your salvation today, whatever. Just check your salvation meter, whatever that means. And slide down here. Verses 12 and 13 is what I took out of Romans, so you can just mark your Bible. But I want to slide down here in 15. It says, see, I have set before you today life and death and evil. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I command you today by loving the Lord your God, by walking in his ways, and by keeping his commandments and his statutes and his rules, what does it say, class? Then you shall live and multiply. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land you're entering and take possession of it. But and everybody's probably saying amen, and I'd like to applaud that. But 17 comes up with this. It says, but if your heart turns away, and you will not hear, but are drawn away to worship other gods. So I don't know what other gods are for you, but there's other gods out there. You guys know the TV and the internets and the different things. And you can get drawn away by even working too much. That could be end up being a god. And sometimes I got to watch it because a lot of people are like, oh, man, you work too much. You need to settle down. And really, be quite honest, I probably do need to take off and smell the roses a little bit. So I don't want work to become my god or church to become my god. I want God to be my God. And I was talking to some people at the bike rodeo, and the bike rodeo was really cool. It's just a bunch of people to get together. We're out at Weldon Springs, and we eat pancakes and sausage, and then we ride bikes around through cones and do silly things. And a guy came up to me, and he's like, we sat down, and we were drinking a bottle of water and eating a hot dog, and we were talking about Jesus, and he was just like, man, he goes, this is really cool. He goes, is this how you guys kind of do it? And I go, yep, pretty much is how we do it. And when I'm talking to guys, I don't want to make it real complicated because I'm afraid that they would be like me and that they would like miss it. And I go, this is it, man. We're just kind of here like you're here, and we're just praising God, and we're going to be here a minute, and we're going to praise God. And if you want to come down, he goes, yeah, man. He's like, I'm going to be there. You know, it's a big group from Warrington, and I was excited about that. So I think if we would just be real with people and tell them about Jesus, they'd probably continue to come and probably get born again. Hallelujah. Or born from above. So 17, if your heart turns away and you will not hear him but are drawn away to worship other gods and serve them, I declare today you will surely, what does it say? You will surely, and I don't know about perishing. I that really gets in my craw. Perishing? I mean like perishing. You know, you just perish. You just go and you die in your sin, and we know what the Bible says about that. Those die in their sin end up burning forever. And that's just really not an option for you guys or for me or for my family. So I'm going to do whatever it takes to continue to preach the Word of God and tell people about Jesus. And then I'll leave the results, watch me, I'll leave the results up to God. And then it usually works out really well. But I have to be loving, and I have to present the gospel that way. Amen? So turn back with me into the book of Romans, and I'll ask you to stand with me, and I'll ask the pastors and the deacons to come forward as we finish up at least the thought about being born again. And I want to challenge you. So here's the challenge now. So I'm going to ask you this question first, if you've been born again. And it can't be real difficult, because there was a young lady that was here last night. She was 8 years old, and she not only she gets saved, but she got baptized. And when she got in the tub, she was so cute, and her family are moving, and she wanted to make sure that was done. She says, we're getting ready to move, so I was saved, now I want to be born again, I want to be baptized. And when she came down in that tub, she reminded me of my two daughters. You know, I baptized Rocky when she was 7, and Keelan got baptized when she was 7. They understood the Lord, and this girl did too. So it's not difficult. It's not difficult. You'll have to step out in faith. You'll have to do that. You'll have to step out in faith. You might ask this question right now. Will Jesus meet me there when I step out in faith? He will meet you there. And maybe right now you're praying for some people that didn't show up to church, but you keep inviting them. Keep inviting them. They'll come. Just keep inviting them. Just go. Let them know, though, I'm not going away. Just let them know, say, I'm not going away because you're too valuable to me. And it may be children or grandchildren or spouses or whatever. Don't let them go. Pray for them every day and call them up and go, you know what? I'd like you to come to church with me. Because we believe that this is how this gets done, where people hear the Word of God and they're rubbing shoulders with like-minded believers, and all of a sudden something supernatural happens when you invite the power of the Holy Spirit in when the Word is preached under the anointing. And something like this happens. Watch this. It says, because if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved, or born again, or born from above. For with the heart one believes is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For Scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. For there's no distinction between Jew or Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Now listen to this. I'm going to turn, and I'm going to ask the praise team to come forward and start playing. And I'll end this with Matthew 12:37. This could be as important as anything I say today. I just want you to listen to this just for a second, because this is like crazy today. The word is fresh. It's a fresh word. Listen to what it says. For by your words, you will be justified. And by your words, you will be condemned. So that means everybody's got to report to the CEO's desk. Everybody. And when you go before his desk, Jesus will look at you and he'll say, why should I let you into my heaven? You better have an answer. And it can't be like them ones that you used to give, like I used to give. You just kind of shrug your shoulders to the teacher and like, I don't know. That don't work with Jesus. Because if you don't have the proper response, he'll say, away from me, you evildoer, I never knew you. And like, is there like a second chance? Like you could do it like later? Nope. This is it. That's why I never pass up an opportunity to lead somebody to Jesus. It is so vitally important that this nation and these individuals turn back to Jesus. Because when you have Jesus, you have the power. Let's pray. Do you know the King? Oh, God, when I think about you. What do you think about when you think about Jesus, church? What do you think about him? You think he's got the power to save your soul today? You think he's got the power to raise the dead and make the blind see and the lame walk? He does. Does he got the power, listen to me, to save you from your situation? Does he have the power to save your relationship? Does he have the power to save your children and bring your children back from the mess that they're in? Church, you better have an answer for that. Because if you don't have an answer, we're all doomed. But the answer is Jesus. And all you have to do is say his name. And maybe you want to say it right now. Sometimes when I'm frightened and I don't know what to do, I just say Jesus, and I'll just say it, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. You know what? Sometimes things get so crazy in this world, I just go, you know what? I'm just going to say his name, because there's power in the name. I don't know who I'm talking to today. But some of you guys just need to say his name. And some of you guys need to ask him into your heart. Anybody that needs to be saved ought to just raise their hand right now and just say, Jesus, save me. There was a young man. I seen that hand. Oh, God. There was a young man that used to attend this church, and I gave the same altar call some years ago, and he leaped off the seat and he said, save me, Jesus. He went on home to be with the Lord just a couple weeks ago. That's good news, church. Yeah, we'd like to have him here. I thought he was a good kid, and he left behind some children. But the good news is he was born again. Do you see how powerful it is? It got a young man to leap off of his chair. And he knew in his heart, he said, I got to be saved. He said, save me. And he was saved. I miss him. I miss that young man in this church. But I'm so glad he got Jesus. So what's it going to be today? Is it going to be a new day for you? Are you going to walk out of here and go, man, I wish I'd have made that decision? Or how about you saints, everybody that's saved? Is there something you're struggling with? Family? Friends, if you're shaking your head or you're raising your hand or you're kind of trying to get out of here or whatever, you probably need to get down to the altar, because the enemy's trying to get you out of here. God's trying to talk to you. And what you do is you just lay it down. I like coming to the altar. I love coming to the feet of Jesus. I just get before him and go, God, you know exactly what's going on in my heart. I got some real crazy, weird things going on in my life, and I just want you to fix them. All he's asking for you to do is submit. Just raising your hands before the Lord is an international sign of submission. That means you give up. That doesn't mean you're quitting on life. It just means you're going to quit trying to control your life and you're going to let Jesus control it. That's all that means. It don't mean you're a sissy. Some of the greatest men that ever graced this country are born again believers and women. Don't let the enemy talk you out of salvation and repentance. This is where cleansing is when you get right with Jesus. So I'll just pray. Lord, just bless us today in Jesus' name.